This video is meant to be your very first step into unit testing. So we're going to talk about what even is unit testing and why is it important. I'm going to show you a real example in code, and then we'll talk about should you even bother writing these unit tests. Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. A unit test is where we test a small piece of code to ensure it gives us the expected outcome. Think of a basic function that takes in two numbers and adds them together. And in my head, I like to think of functions like little factories, right? In this case, it takes in two inputs, right? Two numbers, and then it does something to them. It's adding them together, and then it spits out a result. In this case, it'll spit out the sum of the numbers. So what a unit test does is it makes sure that that factory is working as expected and it's doing what it's supposed to be doing. Because let's say 6 months down the road, a new developer comes into this code base and maybe they change the plus sign to a minus sign. Well, when we write a unit test, we're testing to make sure that that function is adding numbers together. So if a developer comes in and changes that, our unit test will catch that because that test will fail. And we'll dive into a more detailed example later in the video, but that's an introduction to what a unit test is and what it does. And I want to stress the word unit because that's the whole point. Ideally, you want to test the smallest piece of code possible. Now, the example I just showed you, adding two numbers together, you can't get much simpler than that. But you can imagine if you had a function that was 40, 50 lines of code long, which you shouldn't really have anyway, but the idea is if you have a really long, involved function, that is going to be a nightmare to test. So if you want to write good, testable code, you want to break it down into the smallest chunks possible, which you should probably be doing anyway. So why is unit testing important and what are the benefits? Well, first and foremost, it can prevent errors or regressions. What's a regression, you ask? Well, I think we've all been there. You ever had a piece of code that was working and then later on you came in, maybe you tried to add a little functionality to it, or you did a little refactoring, or maybe you deleted a line of code you thought wasn't doing anything, and then bam, everything breaks. Well, that's called a regression because things were working, now they're not working, so you went backwards. And a lot of times regressions are sneaky, right? You can change something in one area of the code, but then it breaks something in another area because everything's interconnected. And that's why having great unit tests written, right, when you're testing that the factory is doing what it's supposed to be doing, you can catch those regressions when you run the tests and fix them right then and there. So as you can see, having good unit tests gives the developer a level of confidence, right, a level of safety that you can maneuver in the code base, change things, refactor things, and you know your tests are gonna catch any errors you may introduce. So this allows a developer or developer team to work a lot faster due to that safety and confidence. And this is really, really important when you're working on a large team of developers. Now, this is a good time to point out that your tests are only as good as you make them. What I mean by that is if you don't think of all the edge cases or all the ways that your code can break and write a test to cover that, well, then your tests aren't really gonna save you. And learning how to recognize these edge cases and write tests for them does just come with time, experience, and practice, right? You're not gonna finish watching this video and be a testing expert. It's gonna come with time. Okay, let's dive into a code example. Here I am in Xcode with a basic tip calculator app. For example, the user types in, you know, 500, they can drag the slider to see the tip and then what the bill total would be. So I'm not gonna go over all the SwiftUI code because we're really focused on this tip calculation code, because that's what we're going to test. But if you do want to follow along, I'll scroll back up to the top, pause the video, there's the code, scroll down a little bit, pause the video, there's the rest of the code. But again, we're focused on testing, so down here into our calculation struct, which by the way, I just put in the same file just for ease of use on the video. A lot of times you'll see your models or anything like this in a separate file. Let's walk through what's going on with this function. You can see I'm calculating the tip, I'm taking in the entered amount, which is a double, and then the tip, which is a double. So where am I getting the entered amount and the tip? So the entered amount here on the slider, the on change, is this text field. Now the entered amount here is a string because it is in a text field. So I do have to convert that to a double. So essentially, you know, that will return a nil if they entered like some emojis or maybe multiple decimal places, or if they entered a string that can't be converted into a double, this will return nil. And I'm just printing invalid entry. This is where you would show them an error. And then cool, once I know I have a good amount, it's a proper double, then I am calculating the tip by calling calculation.calculateTip of amount with tip slider. And then as you can guess, tip slider is coming from the slider here where I pull out, you know, 0 to 100. You can tip 0% or 100%. And then I pass in the tip slider amount there, and then I calculate the tip and the total amount. So this is the small piece of code, the unit that we want to write tests for. So the first thing we need to do is add a test target to our project. Now, if you're creating a brand new project from scratch, you'll see this pop up. Check that little box and you'll get what we're about to do, you know, for free out of the box. But if you have an existing project that you haven't written tests for, we need to add a testing target, and that's what we're gonna do. So I'll go to File, New Target. Here you can type in test. You can see there's UI test or unit testing bundle, which is a unit testing bundle. UI test is a completely separate topic. Now you can see you'll get tip calculator test. That's fine for now. All this should be good. Hit finish. And there you go. Now you have new tip calculator tests over here. And this gives you basically boilerplate of how tests work, right? You get set up, tear down, test example. We're gonna dive into this later, but what I wanna point out is if you just kept it default, tip calculator test, tip calculator is the name of the app, by the way, that's like a test for your whole app. And as you can imagine, a big app, that file is gonna get a little unruly. So what you want to probably do is, and this gets into project organization, which is subjective, but this is just my recommendation, is create new files for every section of your app. Now, of course, our app is only a tip calculator, but you can imagine if you had 10 screens and, you know, a bunch of different functionality, you'd want a different file for each little section of functionality just to keep things organized. So I'm going to do that. Right click, new file, say unit test case class, hit next. We're going to call this calculation tests because my struct is called calculations. I'll show you that in a second. So hit next. Yep, make sure your target is on the tip calculator test target, not just the app target. Hit create. Cool. So you see, I basically got the same thing. The only thing that changed was the name. But again, I wanted to point that out because, you know, you're probably gonna have a lot of these files testing different areas of your code. So the reason I call this calculation test is back to my content view, is because I have this struct called calculation. Now, this simple example only has one function, but you can imagine if I had something called calculation, maybe I have 10 functions that are calculating a bunch of different stuff. So that is why I named it that. Now we're going to delete all this because we're going to write our own here. Now back to the content view, I'm actually going to pull it up side by side. We're going to get rid of the preview so I can see the code here. Cool. So I got my calculation code here and then my tests over here. So the first thing I like to do is test what we call, again, the happy path. Like, if this code works properly, what should I expect? So when you write a test, you want to call it func and then test. It always needs to start with test and then whatever you're testing. So I'll say successful tip calculation. The basic structure of a test is you want to basically set up your variables, do something, and then assert what the result should be. So oftentimes you'll see given, when, then. You'll also see this called arrange, act, assert. I kind of like the arrange, act, assert better. You'll see why once we do this. So the first thing we need to do is arrange our data, essentially. So for calculate tip, we want to give an entered amount and a tip amount. And here's where we're setting up the scenario that we want to test. And because we're testing, you know, the happy path, what's supposed to happen, we're not going to give it anything crazy. So we'll say let entered amount equal 100.00. $100, and then we'll say let tip slider equal 25.0. And I'm adding 0.0 so it can be a double and it doesn't assume it's an int. So like I said, we're setting up our parameter, setting up the scenario that we want to test. So that's us arranging, or those are the givens. So now we act, or when, you know, when this happens, or we act. So now we want to say let tip equal calculation. Okay, so I don't have access to this calculation struct. And this is something you're probably gonna have to do most of the time. So you can do at testable and then import your app name. So tip calculator. What this does is this gives your testing file here access to all the objects in your app. So now I will have access to this calculation struct. So we're actually going to create that up here. We'll say let calculation equal. We'll initialize a brand new calculation struct. So let tip equal calculation dot calculate tip of entered amount with tip slider. And I'm gonna put this onto two lines so we can make that neater. Okay, so I am calculating the tip. It's basically running this function with these parameters being passed in. So that is the act, that is what is happening. So now I wanna assert, I basically wanna give it the answer. So we use xc assert, and you can see there's a bunch of these here. Assert nil, true, false, equal, not nil. So whatever testing situation you're in, whatever you wanna test, use the proper assert. Most of the time you're going to be using these top ones, right? True, false, equal, maybe nil. You'll see us use nil in a second. So we're going to use equal. So we want to make sure our tip, which is what we calculated here on line 20, equals 25. And that is because you wanna make sure a 25% tip on 100 equals 25. So you are manually giving it the answer because you wanna test to make sure that this factory, this function, is doing the proper thing. So now if I click this little diamond, I can run this test. And you can see test succeeded, get the green check marks because it is working as expected. Now you may be thinking, well, if I'm giving it the parameters and giving it the answer, like what's it testing? Because let's say on this entered amount plus or times tip percentage, let's say we just did a minus instead of a multiple sign. You know, another developer came in there, changed it maybe by mistake or maybe thought they were doing something. Well, now when I run my test, because I've set up these parameters that, hey, this should equal 25. Well, now it's gonna fail because 99.75 is not equal to the 25 as expected. So you can see how now, if someone goes in and changes the code later, the factory still has to do what it's supposed to do. And that's what the test is checking for. So let's change this back to the multiple sign, right? Entered amount times tip percentage. And then let's run our test again to make sure they're working green. Cool, good to go, test succeeded. So that is the happy path, that is as expected. But again, your tests are only as good as you make them. You wanna cover the edge cases and the various ways this can fail. So the next thing I wanna test is, if I close out my system editor, go back to my content view to get my preview up just to show you this, well, we're relying on the user to enter a bill amount. So sure, when they enter, hey, my bill was $100, things will work. But we wanna cover, when the user does something silly, right? What if the user says, my bill was -$4,500? Well, a bill is not gonna be negative, so you don't wanna calculate a tip on a negative. So we wanna account for the case where they enter a negative. And if you look at our calculation, we are accounting for this, right? Guard entered amount greater than zero. So if I go back to my test here, so now I'm gonna copy and paste this test down here, and we're gonna call this, instead of test successful tip calculation, we're gonna call this test negative entered amount tip calculation. And it's fine if your test names are really long and descriptive. So entered amount, let's test -100. So if we look at our code, what should happen when we pass in a negative? Well, you can see guard entered amount, make sure it's greater than zero. If not, we're returning nil. And real quick, the reason I'm returning nil is because that's where I'm gonna show the error. I'll move this over real quick so we can see. If tip comes back nil, we're just printing bill amount or tip cannot be negative. That's where we would maybe show like an error to the user. Again, just a contrived example for educational purposes, but that is why I'm returning nil. So I also wanted to show you how to assert nil and test this. So now we're testing the negative amount entered. So what should happen when we calculate the tip with -100? Again, entered amount will be less than zero, so we're returning nil. So down here in our assert, this is the only thing that changes really, is instead of assert equal, let's do xc assert nil. And what is nil? Tip should be nil. That's what this calculate tip returns. So we're saying, hey, when we get a negative amount, it should be nil. So if we run our test, this should pass, again, because our code hasn't changed. We're writing the test to make sure if it does change, we'll catch it. So for example, let's say some developer comes in here and I don't know, they decide to take out this guard statement on line 78. I'll just comment it out. Well, the code will still work, right? Because if a user just only enters positive numbers, we'll never even see this bug. We'll only see this bug if the user enters a negative number. So now when we run our test, and by the way, you can do command U to run all of your tests, or you can just hit the little triangle there. But you see this one failed because this line of code is gone. Someone thought it wasn't useful, but now we caught it with our tests. And I'm gonna stop here with the code examples, but we could test a negative tip amount. It would be very similar to that. And again, you wanna think of all the edge cases, all the way this function can break, and then write a test case for it. That way, if someone ever does come in and change the code, like you just saw, the test will catch it and you'll know right away. Okay, let me put this line of code back, do a command U to make sure my tests are all passing. Cool, tests are passed, we're good to go. Now you may be thinking like, okay, we did all this code, all these checks for a very simple, small chunk of code, and I only did two examples, there's more to be had here. You might be thinking like, man, in a real app with tons of code, I'm gonna be writing tons of tests. That's a lot of time, effort, and work. Like, is that worth it? Before we talk about if you should write unit tests, let me tell you about today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio, blog, or personal website up and running very quickly. Now I know, we're all developers with these skills and the desire to build the web page ourselves. But I would argue there's an opportunity cost to your time. If you're an iOS developer trying to build a great product, a great app, maybe spending a lot of time learning the ins and outs of web development, responsive design, isn't the best way to spend your time. That's why I recommend Squarespace to build that personal website, the blog, your portfolio, or maybe a landing page for your app. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started. They handle all the analytics and the SEO for you. Again, it just saves you so much time so you can get back to doing what you want to do, and that is building iOS apps. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com to start your free trial. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. Okay, there's no doubt that writing good tests takes a lot of work, time, and effort. There's also no doubt that there's a lot of benefit from that work and effort. So the magic question to ask yourself, is all that work and effort worth it? And as always in programming, it depends. There's no concrete right answer for everyone. Because here's the deal, here's what I want you to think about. Whether you're an indie developer, a small startup, or a huge company, one of the most, if not the most, valuable resources you have is your developer time and effort, where you focus your developers. That is so valuable to a technology company. So as you can imagine, if you're a small startup, maybe you have one developer, two developers, and you're still trying to figure out the product, right? You're still iterating, it's changing a lot. Maybe you don't have a lot of users. Well, it makes sense that the best use of that developer's time is to focus on the product, build something users actually want to get users. If that developer is spending half their time writing unit tests for features that are gonna change in a month, well, you can imagine that startup and that product is probably not gonna move fast enough to succeed. Now, of course, that's an extreme example, but let's go to the other extreme. Say you're YouTube, you have a billion users and you have a team of 100 developers. Well, now, unit tests are a very important part of your workflow and absolutely critical to allowing that team to effectively work on that insanely large code base and make sure things don't break for your billions of users. So those are the two opposite ends of the spectrum on should you write unit tests. So where you fall on that spectrum, depends on, again, how many users you have, how large your team is, what's the maturity of your product. Is it constantly changing still? Because you're still trying to figure it out. So that's why the answer to should you write unit tests for your project is it depends. And hopefully that example of those two extremes will help you navigate that a little bit. And it's not all or nothing either, right? It's not like either I write zero unit tests or I go for 100% code coverage, which you probably shouldn't do anyway, right? Even if you are that indie dev or small startup, if you have a critical piece of code, something you know is not gonna change, yeah, go ahead and write unit tests just for that little bit. Again, you can write unit tests for whatever chunk of code you want. So that's why the answer of should you write tests, how much should you write, it's different for every app, project, team, etc.